We're going to be looking in our service a wee bit later on at part of Ephesians chapter 5, 15 through to 20. And really, it's advice about how we should walk wisely in life. So we're going to be having a look at what that means to walk wisely. But before we get there, I just want to remind us of what worship is all about, according to the writer of the Hebrews in chapter 12. In verse 28, he tells us that when we approach God, therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us be thankful and so worship God acceptably, with reverence and with awe. That's how he wants us to come before him, in an acceptable way, with reverence and with awe. So let's just take a moment to take those words in and pray together and ask God to be with us. Lord God Almighty, thank you that our hope is in Jesus, and that in Jesus we are secure, that he is our fortress, our strong rock, and even though the storms may come our way, we can't be shaken, and nothing can dislodge us from your love. So we come with confidence now, and as we come to worship, we pray too that you would help us to come acceptably, with reverence and with a real sense of awe at your majesty. So hide us now under the shadow of your wings. Free up our praise, feed our souls, inspire our prayer, and use all of those things together to shape our lives so that we might live in such a way that gives you glory and honour for Jesus' sake. Amen. So our first hymn this morning is the words are going to come up on the screen. How sweet the name of Jesus sounds. Screen, hopefully, and that begins beloved in Christ. Like I said of late, normally in a church van service, the minister would say these words, reminding everybody about why they're here and what we're going to do together. But I think these are great words to say together as we remind ourselves and each other why we're really here. So let's say them together. Beloved in Christ. Beloved in Christ, we come together to offer to Almighty God our worship and praise and thanksgiving, to confess our sins and to receive God's forgiveness, to hear his holy word proclaimed, to bring before him our needs and the needs of the world, and to pray that in the power of his Spirit we may serve him and know the greatness of his love. So let us confess our sins to God our Father. I'm going to put the words of the confession up now, and as those are coming up, let's take a moment to think about how the week's been and to ask God's Spirit to show us those things that we most needfully need to bring before him with sorrow because they've been a part of our lives this week. We say together, Heavenly Father, Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought, word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault, by what we have done and by what we have failed to do. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Merciful Lord, grant to your faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you with a quiet mind, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O Lord, open our lips.
And our mouths.
O God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
The Lord's name be praised.
We're going to put the words of Psalm 111 up on the screen. You can't tell the way it's written in English these days, but in its original language, this is what you would have called an acrostic psalm. And apart from the first line, which begins, Hallelujah, I will praise the Lord with all my heart, the next 22 lines, as you would have found it in the original language, always just followed the letters of the alphabet, the first one beginning with A, the second B, and all the way through. And really, it was written as a poem, and it was written in this way, specifically to highlight to us what it is to live a godly life, what a godly person should look like. Hallelujah, I will praise the Lord with all my heart in the assembly of the upright and in the congregation.
The Lord's works are great, studied by all who delight in them.
All that he does is splendid and majestic. His righteousness endures forever.
He has caused his wonderful works to be remembered. The Lord is
He has provided food for those who fear him. He remembers his covenant forever.
He has shown his people the power of his works by giving them the inheritance of the nations.
The works of his hands are truth and justice. All his instructions are trustworthy.
They are established forever and ever. In life and in truth and uprightness.
He has sent redemption to his people. He has ordained his covenant forever. His name is holy and awe-inspiring.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All who follow his instructions have good insight. His praise
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
So our reading comes from Ephesians 5, verses 15 to 20. They may well come up on the screen. Yay, there we go. Pay careful attention, then, to how you walk, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of the time, because the days are evil. So don't be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. And don't get drunk with wine, which leads to reckless actions, but be filled by the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing and making music from your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for everything to God the Father, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Father, as we have read your word now, we pray that you would help us to understand it. Show us what these words specifically mean for each of us as we live out our daily lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, they tell you that walking is meant to be good for you, and I think by and large it likely is. So let me quote to you a little bit from the NHS, the National Health Service website, and tell you what they say about walking. It says, walking is simple, free, and one of the easiest ways to get more active, lose weight, and become healthier. It can help you build stamina, burn excess calories, and make your heart healthier. So if you can do that, well, what's there not to love about walking? It's a great idea. And I think one of the great things it goes on to say is that it's not about walking for hours. You don't have to be able to walk for hours. Though if you want to, by all means, stretch your legs and go and do it. But it says even 10 minutes of vigorous walking every day accrues a whole list of benefits that are good for our physical and our mental health. And so it continues to say that everybody, if they're able to at all, should try and make walking a part of their daily habit. Try and include it in the daily routine. And on the same website, it gives some examples of what it means by that and how easy it actually might be to incorporate walking into your daily routine. It says, if you live near the shops, if you're in the village, rather than drive around, it says, walk around. If you're in a building where you've got to go up a couple of flights of stairs to make a call or a visit, don't use the lift. Actually, use the stairs instead. If you're going on a short journey, consider walking it or even cycling it, for that matter. And one of the things they say is a great idea is just coordinate with a friend. Encourage a friend to go walking with you, because then you can have a bit of a chat on the way, share a bit of banter on the way, and encourage each other to get a wee bit of activity into our lives as well. So it gives all sorts of examples like that. And then it tells us that there's an app. You can download an app from the NHS. There's loads of others that you can download. You can put it on your phone, your tablet, I think maybe on some watches these days. And the purpose of the app is simply to encourage us, to help us plan, set our goals for getting fitter, track our progress, and to stay motivated. This reading from Ephesians 5, in a way, if you were to take the whole chapter, would be a wee bit like an app, because it would help us to walk with Jesus. It gives us lots of good advice as to how we should walk with Jesus. It would help you plan to do that if you read it and apply it to your lives. It would help you set goals, iron out the things that shouldn't be there, encourage you into the things that should be there. It would help you track your progress. It would help you to stay motivated. So I know apps are very modern and up to date, and it's all part of the gadgetry that we have these days. But sometimes the good old-fashioned approach is as good as anything, and it's all there in the Word of God. And chapter 5 of Ephesians is a great app. It's the original app about holy living, if you like, or walking closely with God. And so chapter 5. Just to sort of summarize what's going on in the chapter before we get into some specific verses, begins by saying walk. It tells us that we ought to be walking, but it says walk in love. Just as Jesus walked in love, just as Jesus left all that was in glory for him and came and shared our human life and walked amongst us in love, and then showing us how far he would go to demonstrate that love when he went to the cross. So it says walk in love like Jesus. And chapter 5 gives us a picture of what that would look like. It shares with us some of the things that we should be building into our lives so that we begin to look a bit more like Jesus, that we try to walk with him and for him. And it gives us a few examples of things that maybe shouldn't be there as well. And then it goes on and it says, walk as children of light, finding out what is acceptable to the Lord, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness. So that's the sort of the overview of the chapter. But this morning, I just want to stick with two verses, because there's loads in there for us to take hold of. And that's the advice that Paul gives us in verses 15 and 16. And just let me remind you what's there. It says, be careful then how you live. In other words, about how your walk is with God, how you walk with Jesus. Be careful then how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of the time because the days are evil. So let's see what we can glean from these two verses, because I think Paul is trying to say two things in particular to us about how our walk with God should be. And the first thing that he says is that we should live wisely. Now, what does that mean? Well, I think our minds probably veer off in the wrong direction when we hear that word wise, because we tend to think that wisdom is something about accruing knowledge. It's about reading books. It's about doing exams and all the rest of it so that we become walking encyclopedias. Well, there's absolutely nothing wrong with doing any of those things. And you'll probably enjoy a quiz show a whole lot more if you read a few books. But that's not what Paul's talking about when he refers to wisdom. Wisdom in this context means that we choose to live the way that God asks us to live. That we make a conscious decision to walk in the world as his ambassador, as a representative of him, living the way he expects us to live, being flexible and willing to go where he asks us to go to serve him and to present Jesus in all circumstances. So living means choosing to live. Wisdom means choosing to live the way that God asks us to live. And that, by inference, is wise living. Because God is good. By nature, God is good and can't be anything other. And all the plans that he has for my life and yours have got to be good. Now, we don't always feel that because life blows us about in storms from time to time. And we're not always sure what's around the corner. And sometimes there's potholes that we trip in. Sometimes there's mountains to climb and holes to fall down. But whatever life brings our way, God is always good. And so why would we choose to live any other way other than God's way when we know that he has our best interests at heart all the time? That is what living wisely is. So why would we choose to live foolishly by ignoring God's plan for our lives, by living some other way? You see, when you become a Christian, when that moment comes where Jesus makes sense to you and you take hold of him and you commit your life to him, you don't then have the option of just drifting on through life indiscriminately doing whatever it is that you want to do. When you give your life to Jesus, it is about a submission, not a submission that locks you down with chains and a key and a padlock, but a submission that sets you free. But nevertheless, when you become a Christian, there is a plan that God expects you to embrace. There is a road, there is a pathway that he expects you to walk. There is actually an exactness in God's plan for my life and for your life. Because we're meant to adopt a new style of life, a lifestyle that reflects his purposes for our lives, a lifestyle that gives glory to him, a lifestyle that reflects him to the world rather than highlights us. There are principles involved in walking that walk. They're all set out for us in the scriptures, which is what makes it so important that we learn to grapple with it, to read it, to digest it, to apply it to our lives. And this isn't just something that Jesus has dreamt up or Paul has dreamt up later in the New Testament. This is a thought that pervades the whole of the scriptures. So if you jump back into the Old Testament, for example, into the book of Proverbs, say to chapter 2, a lot of that book, a lot of that chapter is all about walking the wise path and rejecting the path of the wicked. Learning to discern what God's path is and choosing not to stray onto the path of the wicked, living according to God's word. And it's highlighted throughout the breadth of scripture for us because it knows how weak we are and it knows how easily we are swayed by the other attractions of the world around us. And we've got to remember that the world has a different set of values to those that the Christian very often is asked to live by. And those values seek to ensnare us at times and to lure us off the narrow path onto that broad path. It's absolutely crammed full of people. And so if we're going to walk the narrow road, if we're going to walk wisely, if we're going to walk like Jesus and live for Jesus, then that's going to require us to be determined to do it. It's going to require us to be resilient about it. We need to be courageous in doing it because it is a minority of people who choose to walk Jesus' way, certainly in the part of the world that we live. And it will require us to be wise. And that is at least part of what Paul means when he tells us that we should be wise in the way that we walk, because we need to be wise to the false claims that the world makes. The claims that always tell us that whatever you're enjoying now, the grass is inevitably greener on the other side of the fence and you should go and try it out. We need to be wise to the tactics of the enemy, the devil. And in this world, I presume in society today, most people don't even believe in him any longer. It's little wonder that the Bible describes the devil as the deceiver. He's there to deceive us, and if we don't even believe in him, he's already managed to get a significant foothold in our lives by deceiving us into thinking that he's not there, and it's something that we shouldn't be concerned about. So we need to discern the way that he works. We need to be wise in choosing every day to put on the armour of God, because those are the things that God gives us to protect us from the deceiver, to prevent us being ensnared by his false claims and the false claims of the world. We need to be wise about seeking God's guidance, recognising that we are vulnerable and we make wrong choices, and that we really need his spirit to be the one who oversees and guides our lives. We need to be wise to our own weakness so that we can appreciate God's strength, so that we can depend on him rather than depending on ourselves. So the walk that he's calling us to have, this walk of wisdom, requires us to be wise in so many ways. And if we are feeling that we are inadequate now, hearing all of that, well, then we just need to ask for that wisdom. It's not something that God is looking to withhold from us. He tells us to walk in that wisdom. So it's there, it's freely available. So just keep asking him for the wisdom to walk as Jesus, for Jesus in the world. There are many things about this world that I find are absolutely astonishing. In lovely ways, like the beauty of God's creation all around us is astonishing. But there are other things that astonish me in not such a good way. And I think one of the astonishing things about the world is that it already thinks that it's wise, that it possesses all the wisdom and the right wisdom. And the world tends to look at Christians and say to them, "You're foolish." Well, you know, when you read the Bible, it actually turns out right round on its head. And it tells us we're not foolish for falling in love with Jesus and following him, but the world is very foolish for rejecting him. And so the greatest fool in the world, the Bible tells us, is the fool who says there is no God. Now, we take a sigh of relief at this point because we think that that may not apply to us and our loved ones. But this isn't necessarily referring just to somebody who is an atheist and outrightly denies the existence of God. This is somebody who just simply says that God doesn't have a claim on their life. This is somebody who isn't submitted to Jesus. Somebody who's intent on living through life, waving at God from a distance, paying him lip service, and just doing what they want. And so, the fool that is being referred to here quite often can just be an ordinary, decent, upright, good neighbour, a decent citizen, somebody who is just a solid person, but they just don't think that they have to live by God's standards. They just think that they've got to do life the way that they want. And that could be anybody, could be any of us. So Paul says, be wise to all those things. Be wise to the way the deceiver works, and draw your strength, your inspiration, your courage, and your wisdom from God, and then walk in that. Now the second thing that Paul says in these two verses is found in verse 16, and he says, making the most of the time because the days are evil. So he's saying, walk in this wisdom, walk the walk with Jesus because the days are evil. Make the most of the time because the days are evil. Now I think we could possibly look at that sentence in two different ways, and both make sense. And the first way that we can look at it is that we just think that Paul is saying, well, just look, life is short, make the most of every moment that you've got. And there would be nothing at all wrong in that advice. It's good advice. And the older you get, the more you sit around with your friends and say, we've got to make the most of what's left. I was sitting around with some friends the other night. We're all of a similar age. And we were just saying that. We've got to make the most. It sounds morbid, but we've got to make the best use of whatever time's left. And there is nothing wrong with that at all. And I think Paul, given his situation, was especially aware of that. And think of his situation. The number of times he'd been beaten, he'd been shipwrecked, he'd been imprisoned, he'd been stoned, he'd run out of water and food, and he had lost his clothing on different occasions. And so he knew what it was like to live on the edge, to understand that the next day might be his last day. And we're all in exactly the same position as Paul was. No matter how comfortable we are, none of us know what time we have in this world. And Paul could have been saying that, and it would make sense for Paul to be saying that coming out of his situation. But I think there's more to it here. And I think Paul has been more profound, and he's asking us just to look a little bit harder. And the other meaning is, it's harder to pick out because it's sort of wrapped up in the original language of the verse. Because Paul uses a word for time in this sentence, making the most of the time because the days are short. He uses a word here that in the usual Greek context refers to time that is measured by a clock or a calendar or something like that. I should have said he doesn't use the usual word for time there. The word for time that would normally be in there is the word chronos, refers to clocks and watches and calendars. Instead, he puts another word in place there. And it doesn't mean time measured by clocks and calendars. It means opportunities. So that's different, isn't it? So he's saying that we're to make the most of the opportunities. Now, what opportunities is Paul talking about? What is he trying to say to us? What opportunities is he expecting us to make the most of? Well, he's asking us to make the most of the opportunities that can be grasped for God's glory in our lives. The moments that we have to show to show Jesus to people by how we live. The moments that we have to take our stand for Jesus because we speak out when we need to. The moments that we have to demonstrate our faith. The moments that we have, literally, to live wisely with Jesus, for Jesus, in the world. Accepting his standards, bowing the knee before him, being putty in his hands. Making the most of every opportunity that we have in this life to glorify God and to promote the name of Jesus. There's an old tale, it's an old Greek tale, that's told about a statue. The Greeks were really into their statues. And it's a tale told about a statue called Opportunity. And it stood in the middle of a Greek city. Nobody, I don't know what Greek city it was. And it was carved by a man called Lysippus. And the statue of Opportunity had wings on its feet. It had a big forelock of hair that stuck out from the top of his head. But on the back of his head, there was no hair at all. No hair on his back. No hair in any other part of his body. Completely bald. And underneath the statue, there was a big stone plinth. And into the stone plinth was carved a conversation. And let me read the conversation to you. Who made you? Lysippus made me. What is your name? My name is Opportunity. Why have you wings on your feet? That I may fly swiftly. Why have you a forelock on your head? That men may seize me when I come. Why are you bald at the back? When I'm gone by, no one can lay hold of me. That is a summary of Opportunity. It comes and goes. And quite often in life, when the opportunity has passed us by, it's gone for good. We never get that opportunity again. And this Greek story is just to remind us to make the most of the opportunities. So let's put that into the context of the believer, in the context of a Christian. The Christian who walks in wisdom knows that they should make the most of every opportunity that God gives to them. They know that they may not get another chance. They may not get another chance to tell their loved one about Jesus. They may not get another opportunity to talk to their neighbors and to witness to their neighbors about Jesus. They may not have another opportunity to take their stand amongst their work colleagues and amongst their friends. They may not have the opportunity to honor God in a tricky situation again. And so what Paul is saying here is creating the idea that there is a very definite but also very short season of opportunity for all believers that's called life. And that Christians, that believers in Jesus, have got to make the most of every opportunity that comes their way to give glory to God. And the unasked question, the question that just leaves us all squirming a wee bit, is just, well, how well are we doing that? How well does our life reflect God to the world? How wise are we being in walking through this world? And so, why should we seize every opportunity? Well, verse 16 tells us, because these days are evil. I don't have to persuade you that that's the case. I mean, just turn your televisions on. You can see every night that the news comes on, if you're listening to it on the radio. We just know that the world is an evil place, that these days are evil. I wouldn't know whether they are any more evil now than ever they were, but there is evil in the world. 5 people murdered in Plymouth the other day. Afghanistan being run over. As I was getting out of the car between services, there was breaking news that now Kabul has been surrounded. They're coming from 4 areas at once, and the whole of the country will have fallen probably by the end of the day. And what we see on our TV screens and what we hear on our radios, it's just the tip of the iceberg. as to the amount of evil that's in the world. But that's not something that we need to despair about. There's something that we need constantly to be praying about. But it's nothing to despair about, because here's the thing. In the middle of all of this, in the middle of shootings in Plymouth, in the middle of Afghanistan being overrun, and all the other tragedies of life, God gives us times and opportunities to make things happen that really matter for his kingdom. Nothing that you ever do for God, no matter how dark it feels around you, is wasted. And so, in the name of Jesus, we can bring his peace into the midst of somebody else's troubles. In the name of Jesus, we can bring joy into somebody else's sorrows. In the name of Jesus, we can proclaim release to the captives. In the name of Jesus, we can bring hope to people who feel that they're in hopeless situations. In the name of Jesus, we can help the spiritually blind to see Jesus as we reflect the light of the world in their direction. In the name of Jesus, we can sow the seeds of life, even in the valley of the shadow of death, to reflect the life-giving light of Jesus Christ in the darkness all around us. That is our calling. That is what it is to walk wisely. So don't be afraid to take that thought away with you. And just a little bit later on in the day, when you find yourself with a few moments and a bit of stillness, ask God, so how well am I doing with that? Let's pray. Father God, thank you that you speak to us constantly. Thank you that whatever life brings our way, however rough or smooth the road is, you're always there, constantly before us, behind us, above us, beneath us, and in us through your Spirit. Thank you, Lord, that you journey with us as we take up your call to live life wisely, to live it according to your terms, to live it in your way, to live it according to your timetable. So Lord, knowing that, we're encouraged, but now give us courage, not only to hear this truth, but to accept it, to want it to be part of our lives, to be willing to apply it to our lives. So Lord, help us to examine our own hearts, our own lifestyles, and to allow you by your Spirit to refine it more and more, that we may reflect the light of Jesus more brightly in all of life's circumstances, making the most of every opportunity. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm going to put the words of the Apostles' Creed up on the screen. Just a summary of all the main ingredients of what we believe, and it's good to say them from time to time. It reminds us of the breadth of our faith, the solidness of it, and it's an encouragement to us. So we're going to say these words together. I believe in God. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. We pray as Jesus taught us, as we say together, Our Father,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Show us your mercy, O Lord.
And grant us your salvation.
O Lord, save the Queen.
And grant her government wisdom.
Let your ministers be clothed with righteousness.
And let your servants shout for joy.
O Lord, save your people.
And bless those whom you have chosen.
Give peace in our time, O Lord.
And let your glory be over all the earth.
O God, make clean our hearts within us. Collect of the 11th Sunday after Trinity. O God, you declare your almighty power, most chiefly in showing mercy and pity. Mercifully grant to us such a measure of your grace, that we, running the way of your commandments, may receive your gracious promises, and be made partakers of your heavenly treasure, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Father God, our walk with you so often is unconvincing. We get easily distracted. We lose heart. We stray from the narrow path that you've called us to. And too often we don't walk as children of the light. And too often we don't take time to discern what truly is acceptable to you, our Lord. Too often we choose the darkness over the light. So Lord, help us to cast off such foolishness and to desire to walk wisely with you, giving heed to your word, looking out and welcoming your instructions, trying to live like Jesus and for Jesus. And so we pray this morning for those who have decisions to make right now as they walk through life. For our young people who've just received exam results and they're wondering what comes next. For governments who face the consequences of global warming as fires rage through Turkey and California, as floods sweep through parts of India and China. For those exploring the possibility of changing job or moving house. For those who wonder whether they should get the vaccine or not. For those who will be forced to choose between eating today for themselves or feeding their children. For those who have the choice of another fix or another drink but know that they shouldn't. Lord, life is full of big questions and the answers aren't always immediately obvious. So give wisdom to those who need it to make right decisions. Give guidance to those who cannot see a way forward. And give courage to those whose decisions are hard to make. And we pray for those who have chosen badly. For those whose poor choices have led them into a life of abuse and dependency. For those whose choices have led them into a life of crime and imprisonment. For those whose choices have brought about ill health and disability. Lord, you're a redeemer. We can't fall beyond your reach. We can't be hidden by the darkness of our situation. So Lord, reach into people's hopelessness and lift them out. Give them a fresh start. Help them to find peace, healing, and forgiveness in you. And we pray for those in need, for those who have lost loved ones in recent days. Pray for Beth this morning. their son Alistair, for the rest of that family, for all other families who've lost loved ones in recent times, for those who have received a worrying diagnosis, for those who are struggling with dementia as it takes hold, for those whose financial situation has become critical, for those whose health makes life difficult and painful, and for those who are carers of loved ones and are tired and weary. Lord, you know their needs, and you have heard our cry on their behalf. So have mercy and bring them peace and security, health and healing, strength and determination. And so now, for a few moments, let's bring to God our own thoughts, our own needs, the stresses and strains of life as they affect us and our loved ones and our friends. And so we pray for each other and ourselves as we use the words of the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. So we come to our second hymn. It's our last hymn. It's going to come up on the screen. And it reminds us that the only way to walk wisely is to take our lives and let them be consecrated to God. And by consecration, it means handed over. It means surrendered. Let's sing, "Take My Life and Let It Be." rejoice in your greatness and power, your gentleness and your love, your mercy and justice. So enable us by your Spirit to honour you in our thoughts, in our words and our actions, to live wisely, to serve you in every aspect of our lives, through Christ Jesus our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit, be with us and those whom we love, today and always. Amen.